good morning and happy Sabbath to everyone. Very thankful to be here with you and that we have the privilege to study God's Word together. And I trust that the Lord has something very, very special that He wants to share with all of us. And so I am going to ask you to already begin praying in your heart that God will prepare you to receive what He desires to give us this morning. My first hope and prayer is that you all have Bibles with you. It's going to be very important that you have scripture in your hand. You don't want to make a habit of listening to ministers. You want to make it a habit to study your Bible. And therefore, you can't do that unless you have your Bible in your hand with you. So that's the first thing I want to do, is encourage you to do that. One of the clearest ways that we can know we're not here to learn and we're not here to study is when we're just sitting here listening to a sermon. When I say turn to the Bible and we don't turn to Bibles, we don't lift up anything, we already are testifying that we're not in the best position to receive what God wants to give. God has something special He wants to give to us. And therefore, it's going to require open minds, open hearts, and of course, swords in hand so that we can receive the Word of God. So I want to encourage you to do that this morning, that if you don't have a Bible, and if you don't have any Bible, then please try your best to sit next to someone who has a Bible so that way you can read it. And that you can follow, so that way we all can be edified. As we prepare our hearts for the message this morning, we're going to talk about the experience of the gospel. The experience of the gospel. And I believe that this is a very important message. I was praying all the way up until the very final moments for me to come up here and asking the Lord to just make it plain to my heart, what do the people need? There's many things to say, but the key is, what do the people need? And my hope and my prayer is that what I will be sharing with you is exactly what your hearts needed. And so as we prepare our hearts to receive this message, let us go before the Lord in prayer. And I'm going to invite that as much of you as are able, that you would please kneel with me as we go before the Lord at this time. If you cannot kneel, then you can bow your head where you are. But if you can kneel, I'm asking that you would please join me as we go before the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we are grateful, Lord, for the blessings of life, health, and strength. We thank you, dear God, for the power of your Holy Spirit that convinces us of sin, righteousness, and judgment. And we come to you at this time seeking a blessing from heaven because we're in desperate need of it. And we ask you to please forgive us, Lord, of our sins, that you will please open our eyes and help us to behold wondrous things out of your law. We ask you to teach us today, and may the experience that we have with thee, may we truly be able to say we have sensed the presence of Jesus in this place, and may our lives never be the same. Abide with us now, Lord, and I commit myself into your hands, and I pray that you'll take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Father, this is my prayer that I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Jesus gave a most powerful statement in the book of Matthew, the 24th chapter, and I want you to turn there with me. We're going to the book of Matthew, chapter 24. And when we look at Matthew, chapter 24, we will find the great gospel commission. The great gospel commission. And as you look at this, you're going to notice that Jesus makes it so plain that no one has to miss it. Jesus was going through prophecy. And as he was laying down the line and light of prophecy, he got to a point where as he was explaining to his disciples all of the things that were soon to come in the world, he got to a point in Matthew 24 and verse 14 where the Bible says, and if you're there, please say amen. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 24 and verse 14, the Bible says, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. Jesus was making it known, because you got to understand, before he made this statement, he was talking about all sorts of horrible things that were going to take place. Wars, rumors of wars, and kingdoms against kingdom, and nation against nation. Ultimately, false Christs, and people will even turn their backs on Jesus himself. And Jesus wanted to give a point of assurance by interjecting in his prophetic utterances that if the gospel is preached, Jesus says that when the gospel is preached for a witness unto every nation, he promises that the end shall come. Now, the reason why this is significant to me is because there's a little book called Ministry of Healing. How many of you are familiar with that book, Ministry of Healing? You're familiar with that book? Now, in the book Ministry of Healing, it is on page 363 that it makes a very powerful statement. It says the gospel is a wonderful simplifier of life's problems. I want you to catch that. The gospel is a wonderful simplifier of life's problems. Now, the reason why I love that quotation is because I am an American. I am from America, but yet I'm here on Filipino soil. And here it is that as I'm here, there's much about the culture of the Philippines that in some respects is different from the cultures in America. And yet in the midst of having cultural differences, in the midst of being a man and many of you being women, in the midst of me being young and some being older, in the midst of so much diversity, if there's one thing that I know to be a fact, is that the common denominator between all of us is that all of us have problems. Is that right? Every single one of us in this room, we all have problems. Doesn't matter if you're male or female, doesn't matter if you're young or old, doesn't matter if you're black and white, and it doesn't matter if you're American or Filipino. Brothers and sisters, we all have problems. And here it is that in Ministry of Healing 363, it says the gospel is a wonderful simplifier of life's problems. So whatever problem you and I have, the gospel contains the solution. Now, I just said that from the writings of Ellen White, but quite honestly, you just saw that in Matthew 24. Because look at it again. In Matthew 24, 14, look at it again. It said right there, it said, "And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations." And then what was going to happen? The end shall come. Brothers and sisters, when it talks about the end shall come, one of the things that also will come to an end are problems. You follow that? So therefore, the gospel truly is a wonderful simplifier of life's problems. And therefore, when Jesus talks about the gospel being preached, you and I must understand that that's a blessing. That's a blessing that he wanted to give when he gave the gospel unto mankind. Now watch this. Did Jesus say in the verse, "and a gospel"? Is that what he said? No, he didn't say that. He said, "and what? This gospel." It's kind of like me saying to you, if I went to any of my young friends here in the choir and I said, "do me a favor, give me a chair. Can you give me any chair inside of this room?" Yes, you can, because all I said was, "give me a chair." But if I said, "do me a favor, give me this chair," can you now pick up any chair in the room? No, you can't. You have to pick up the specific one I'm talking about. You get it? And so it is that when Jesus, when he made his statement, he didn't say, "and a gospel," but he said, "and this gospel." Jesus was being specific. Now, the reason that's important is because if you go further down the roads right here, you might find a church called the Church of Christ. And you know what they have? A gospel message. If you go a little bit further, you're going to find someone else that's called Roman Catholic. And if you see them, guess what they have? A gospel. And sometimes if you go even closer to the different parts of Malaysia and what have you, you're going to see that there are going to be Muslims over there. And guess what they have? A gospel. The word gospel simply means the good tidings or good preaching, good news. So Muslims have gospel messages too. They have their own concept of what makes up good news. And you might find Buddhists and you might find people of all different religious persuasions, and they all think they have the gospel. And the question is, which one is right? How do you know? Now, the reason why this is significant is because go to the book of Galatians chapter 1. Let me show you how Jesus talked about this through his servant Paul on this issue of the gospel. I want you to see this because it's going to be imperative. We all have problems. We all need a solution, but the solution is found in the gospel. When Jesus talked about it, Jesus was specific. He was not generic. And therefore, when we are looking for the solutions in our life, we must have a very specific intent and not be wide, broad, and generic either. Now, here it is that in Galatians chapter 1, I'm going to show you a very key reason why Jesus had to be specific when he talked about this gospel. The Bible says in Galatians chapter 1, and when you get there, let me know by saying amen. In Galatians chapter 1, right there in verse 6, you'll notice that the Bible says, Paul is speaking to the brethren in the church of Galatia. And as Paul is talking to them, Paul has made it known God's gospel message, God's truth. But something came in behind them. And notice what Paul, how he articulates it, starting at verse 6. The Bible says in Galatians 1 and verse 6, Paul says, "I marvel." In other words, I'm amazed. He says, "I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto what? unto another gospel. Now look at verse 7 carefully. It says, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would do what? And would pervert the gospel of Christ. Right now, we just learned that not all gospels are equal. That's the first lesson we just caught. Paul says that there are some people that are preaching gospel messages that are actually perversions of the real thing. Do you see what I see? So notice that. Paul says, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you, and they would pervert the gospel of Christ. Verse 8 goes on to say, but though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have received or preached, it says, let him be what? Accursed. Now, you know, I like this verse here. When it says, but though we or a what? What did it say? But though we or an angel from heaven. You know, I like that verse. You know why? Because when I was in one of your malls here, I saw some young men. They were very kind young men. I started to talk to them. And I saw these young men, and one man was Filipino, the other man was Caucasian. And they both had on white shirts with collars, button-down, short-sleeve white shirts. And they had a little black name tag on their shirt. Does anybody know what religion that is? That's the Church of Jesus Christ and Latter-day Saints. So here it is that I saw these brothers, and they're walking through the mall, and I was walking with Brother De La Cruz and my other dear brother, and as we're walking around, I just couldn't help myself. And I said, you know what, there go some Mormons. I said, let me go talk to them. So I just went and talked to them. I said, hey, what are you guys doing? I'd love to find an opportunity to give somebody the gospel. So I just went up to those brothers, hey, what are you guys doing here? Well, you know, we like to go and share. And they started telling me about their mission work. And I'm praying as I'm talking. I always do that. Anytime somebody's talking to me and I'm looking at you, in my mind I'm saying, Lord, help me. Give me wisdom. Bring back to my remembrance everything you've taught me at this time to give this person the right word at the right time. So I'm talking to them, but I'm praying at the same time as I'm talking to them. And as I'm talking with those brothers, they started talking to me, and they started talking about, hey, have you ever read the Book of Mormon? That was what one of the guys asked me. They said, have you ever read the Book of Mormon? I said, well, yes, I have read it. And he said, so what do you think about it? I said, I didn't like it. They said, well, why didn't you like it? I said, well, you know, I said, unfortunately, I said, there are things that you all teach that contradict the Bible. And I said, and your Book of Mormons does that. And I know that you believe that there's an angel named Moroni, and that angel supposedly came and gave these messages that were supposed to complete the Bible. But according to Galatians 1 and verse 8, Paul says, but though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that we have preached, what did the Bible say? Let them be accursed. Brothers and sisters, that angel is cursed. That's why I can't accept the writings of that angel. And I wanted to make it clear to those brothers. And it was nice because we communicated. And even though we talked and I made it clear why I don't stand in position with them, yet and still, we were still able to shake each other's hands and embrace one another. And I said, listen, I pray one day we'll get a chance to dialogue some more. And I gave them a word of admonishment. I said, listen, you men seem very genuine. I said, always remember there's more light to receive. I said, always keep your heart open, man, that there's more light to receive. And they said, you know what? We will do that. And you know what they did? They sent me an email just a day ago, and now we're in email dialogue, which turns into email Bible study. The Bible says, but though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that we have preached, the Bible says, let him be accursed. And then, you know, God is so serious that in verse 9, notice what God says again, Galatians 1, verse 9. Watch this now. The Bible says, as we said before, so say I now again. If any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, the Bible says, let him be accursed. Brothers and sisters, God takes the gospel very, very seriously. And the reason why is because he knows that the gospel is his ordained solution to life's problems. So therefore, God wants to preserve the gospel. Satan wants to pervert the gospel. And you and I are caught right in the middle of this great controversy right now. And if someone came to you and said, I understand that as a Seventh-day Adventist, you preach a gospel. But if someone said to you, how do we know it's the right one? Ladies and gentlemen, anytime the truth is being taught, Satan will do everything possible to distract your mind so that you will lose the very blessing that God had designed and formulated just for you. If the lights turn off again, stay focused. Amen? While the people will tend to it and find out if what's going on, you stay focused. Don't lose the blessing. You pray for me that I stay focused and make sure that I'm still a mouthpiece of God to give the blessing. Amen? So here it is now that the Bible makes it very, very clear that there's a gospel message that Jesus wants to give, and it's the true one, the specific one. But Paul now says, but there are perverted gospels, or I shall say false gospels. And my question to you is, does the Seventh-day Adventist Church have a gospel message? Yes. But the question is, how do we know that we have the right one and not a perverted one? How would we know? How do we know? I want you to think about that with me. How do we know? The reason why I'm asking you that is because you and I may say, well, it has to be according to the word. Isn't that what the Roman Catholics say? They say their gospel is based on the word. Isn't that what the Baptists say? Isn't that what the Pentecostals say? Isn't that what the Church of Christ says? They all say we all go by the word. So it's not enough to just say by the word. Brothers and sisters, do you want to know what's one of the clear signs of how you can know the right gospel from the false one? Go back to Matthew 24. Let me show you. It was right in the verse. When you study the Bible carefully, especially when you study the book of 1 Peter chapter 1, you'll find that one of the things that the Bible or the gospel is called is a seed. You read that in right around 1 Peter chapter 1, right around verse 23 to the end of the chapter. Literally, the gospel is referred to as a seed. Now, whenever you put a seed in a ground, ultimately it's going to have to grow and bear what? Fruit, right? So watch this. The question is this. Since the gospel is a seed, then it must obviously bear fruit. And the question is, what is the fruit or effect of the gospel being preached in all the world for a witness? Notice what it says in verse 14 of Matthew chapter 24 again. The Bible says in Matthew 24 and verse 14, it says, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations. And then whatever comes after then is the fruit. Notice what the Bible says is the fruit. It says, and then shall the what? End come. So whatever gospel that the Bible describes is designed to bring about the end of all things, that is the right gospel. And the question is, does the Bible talk about such a gospel? Yes, it does. Go to the book of Revelation, the 14th chapter. Now we're going to Revelation 14. Right now, I am doing what's called theological discussion with you. I'm talking to your brains. I'm talking to your minds. I'm reasoning with you because I want you to understand what God is trying to say. But then after that, we're going to go from understanding to experience. The Bible says in Revelation, the 14th chapter, and we're going to start at verse 6. The Bible says in Revelation 14 and verse 6, it says, and I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell upon the earth, to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. And worship him that made heaven and earth, the sea, and the fountains of waters. And there followed another angel, saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast in his image and receive a mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever. And they have no rest day or night who worship the beast in his image and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus Christ. Now, what we usually do is stop right there. Revelation 14, 6 through 12 definitely shows us an everlasting gospel message under the banner of three angels. But have you ever wondered what, according to the Bible, is the effect of the message? Notice what it says in verse 14. after the three angels' messages are given, notice what the Bible shows next in verses 14 and 15. It says, and I looked. And what else does it say? Behold, a white cloud, and upon the cloud one sat like unto the Son of Man, having on his head a golden crown, and in his hand a sharp sickle. And another angel came out of the temple, crying with a loud voice to him that sat on the cloud, saying, thrust in thy sickle and reap, for the time is come for thee to reap, for the what? For the harvest of the earth is ripe. So notice that the Bible says that after the three angels' message, gospel message is given, the next thing that happens is harvest time. Have you ever studied what harvest time represents? I wonder what harvest time represents in the Bible. The Bible says in Matthew the 13th chapter, let's find out what harvest time is. Let's let the Bible speak. In Matthew the 13th chapter, now let's go to what the Bible says. Matthew the 13th chapter. When you get there, let me know by saying amen. We're looking at Matthew chapter 13 now, and we're looking at verse 39. Matthew 13 and verse 39, and let's notice what the Bible says. Matthew 13 and verse 39. The Bible says, the enemy that sowed them is the devil. This is Jesus unfolding the parable of the wheat and tares. He says, the enemy that sowed them is the devil. And then what does it say next? The harvest is the what? End of the world. So according to the Bible, what does harvest time represent? The end of the world. Now, what was the effect of the true gospel that Jesus talked about? This gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then the end shall come. What does harvest time represent? End. And the harvest time comes after what messages are given? The three angels' gospel message. So according to the Bible, we can say to our Roman Catholic friends, we can say to our Mormon friends, we can say to our Baptist and non-denominational friends, we can say to all of our Buddhist and Muslim friends, we can let them know that according to the Word of God, the only gospel that has enough power to cause Babylon to fall, to prepare people for the coming of the Lord, and to stand before the Son of Man, according to the Bible, the only gospel that can have this effect is none other than the first, second, and third angel's message. Can you say amen to that? Amen. So if this is the message of the hour, brothers and sisters, don't you agree that this should be the message that should be preached? Every Sabbath, this is the message that should be going forth. Every Sabbath school lesson, this is the message that should be coming out. Every Bible study that we do, this should be the message. Every evangelistic meeting, this should be the message. Because this is the message that's designed to bring harvest time. And what does harvest time represent? The end of the world. Now, let me ask you a question. Let me talk to you. I'm talking to you from my heart. I want to ask you a question. When I went through Revelation 14, 6 through 12, and I was repeating it from memory, I noticed that as I looked at you, many of you were not looking in your Bibles. You were looking at me. Now, question. Were you looking at me because in your mind you're saying, I already know what these verses say? How many of us, by the raise of hands, you were looking at me because you already knew what these verses say anyhow because you heard it before? How many of us were doing that? By the raise of hands. Yeah, how many? Yeah, absolutely. We were doing that because we heard it before. Is there anybody in here who's never heard these three angels' messages of Revelation 14, 6 through 12? Anybody? Up top, bottom? Who's never heard it? So therefore, the great majority of us, we've heard this message before. Is that right? We've heard these things before. And that's why, you know what? That's why now I need to take you from the theory to the experience. Remember, the title of our message is called The Experience of the Gospel, isn't it? You see, brothers and sisters, I'm not dumb. And praise the Lord, God isn't either. And brothers and sisters, he knows that you know the verses, and I knew more than likely you know these verses too. But the question is, have we considered it? You see, what I want you to do now is I want you to go to Romans 1 with me. Observe, Romans 1. I'm giving you appetizers, but we're about to serve the main course in just a moment. In Romans chapter 1, you'll notice that Paul, God's servant, he's now breaking down the gospel, and he begins to teach it in such a way that he explains exactly what the gospel is. Notice what the Bible says in Romans 1 and verse 16, and if you're there, please say amen. The Bible says in Romans 1 and verse 16, it says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, Watch the words. For it is the what? The power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Now watch this. Watch this, saints. According to the Bible, the gospel is God's power. Is that right? Therefore, brothers and sisters, what the Bible is trying to introduce to you and I is that the gospel is not limited to lip service. Power is not simply something you talk about. Power is something you demonstrate. Power is something you experience. Now, if you're the kind of person that likes to write notes in your Bible, I'm going to encourage you to write next to Romans 1:16. I want you to put 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 5. That's if you're the kind of person that likes to take notes, you like to mark your Bible so you can really know where you're going and understand what you read. Go to the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 5, and let me magnify this point of Romans 1:16, and then I'm going to ask you a very important question. Notice this. In Romans, the first chapter, let's notice what the Bible says now as we consider 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. And now we're going to go ahead and look at verse 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 5. Now watch this. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 5, notice what the Bible says. The Bible says, for our what? For our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in what? Power. So do you see how God is differentiating the words from power? Do you see that? So therefore, he says, for our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Ghost and in much assurance, as ye know what manner of men we were among you for your sake. So therefore, the Bible shows that God did not want to limit the gospel to just a bunch of words coming from our mouths. God wanted the gospel to be a power source that can actually change our lives. The focus of that power was to give us victory over sin. The Bible says in Romans 1:16 again, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto something. Unto what? Salvation. Salvation from what? Sin. So now here's my question. My question is not, are you familiar with the words of the everlasting gospel of the three angels' messages? I already know that. God already knows that. You know what I believe our problem is? Not so much that you're not familiar with the words of the three angels. Our problem is we're not familiar of the power of the three angels' messages. We don't know the experience of the first angel. We don't know the experience of the second angel. We don't know the experience of the third angel. And many of us, because we're not familiar with the experience that comes with the message, then what happens is we get stuck in what's called a form of godliness. But we have no power. And this is exactly where the church of God is today. This is why young people can sleep in a message, because in their minds, they're saying it's another sermon with no power. This is why we can have people who can come to church and they sit here like this, and they sit there stubborn, and they refuse to bend or to yield from their various positions. Why? Because they said, I'm tired of lectures. Even the very people that make up the church, saints of God, you know what has happened to us? Many of us don't even believe the very message that God gave to the church anymore. We're just traditional Seventh-day Adventists. We just go through the motions. And brothers and sisters, God can't save anybody like that. What has happened to our passion? What has happened to our excitement? You know, if we had a concert going on up here, and if we had a concert where people can dance side to side, and play some music and beat the drums and everything, oh, nobody'd be sleeping then. Everybody'd be waking up and they'd be like the Israelites before that golden calf, just dancing and worshiping and celebrating. But because it's pure, straight doctrinal teaching, pure, straight words of God, only those who have a love for God and for his truth are the ones that respond to the message. God says, I'm trying to do something in yours and my heart that can help us. You see, brothers and sisters, Jesus gave a commission to the church. Jesus gave a commission. The commission that Christ gave to the church is found in Matthew, the 28th chapter. And in Matthew, the 28th chapter, Jesus' commission to the church was so clear that nobody could miss it. And I want you to look at it and just review it with me, just for time's sake. Don't worry, after tomorrow, I'll be on my way heading back to the U.S. But brothers and sisters, just today, tolerate with me for a little bit. Is that all right? Matthew, the 28th chapter. Notice what the Bible says. Matthew, the 28th chapter. Notice what the Bible says now. And we're looking at Matthew 28 and that great commission that Christ gave to us as it relates to the gospel. Notice what the Bible says. In Matthew 28, notice what it says in verses 18 to 20. And when you get there, let me know by saying amen. In Matthew 28, verses 18 to 20, the Bible says, "And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." Jesus called us to go and preach that gospel. Jesus called us to go and give the gospel. But in order for us to give it faithfully, Romans chapter 2 now has to become our reality. Go to the book of Romans chapter 2. And this is one of the great problems. And by the way, this is one of the problems I believe, especially our youth are no longer excited about the gospel. Many of our youth are no longer excited about it. I'm going to show you right now. Romans chapter 2. Watch this. One of the great reasons I believe many of our youth are no longer excited about the gospel. They're not excited about it. They don't see it as a solution to life's problems. They see it as a problem. But it's not a problem, saints. It's the greatest solution that God has ever given to mankind. Notice what the Bible says in Romans, the 2nd chapter. And I want you to see what the Bible says. Do you know that this is one of the chief reasons why we lose our youth? One of the chief reasons we lose our youth, right here. In Romans, the 2nd chapter, the Bible says in verse 21. And if you're there, please say amen. The Bible says in Romans chapter 2 and verse 21, it says, "Thou therefore which teachest another, teachest thou not thyself?" It says, "Thou that preachest a man should not steal." What's the question? Dost thou steal? He says, "Thou that sayest a man should not commit adultery, dost thou commit adultery?" It says, "That thou that abhorrest idols, dost thou commit sacrilege?" It says, "Thou that makest thy boast of the law through breaking the law, dishonorest thou God?" In other words, Paul is saying, you preach messages, but Paul is saying, are you living the very message that you're preaching? And what happens is when a young person sees a man stand up on a pulpit and says that we are not to go to the movie theater, God's people should refrain from going to the movie theaters and watching all these lewd programs and so on. But then here it is. Sometimes the youth, they come to that same minister's house. And when they come to his house, he has a TV and he has a DVD player. And all he did was he brought the theater in his living room. The youth see that and they say, "Wait a minute, you just told me that I shouldn't go to the theater and watch it. And all you did was you brought the theater to your house." And the young people get confused and they say, "Wait a minute, that's a contradiction. That's hypocrisy." We go to our youth, we say, "Hey, you need to learn what it is to dress like saints of God." But then the youth come to us and they see that our skirts sometimes are just as short as theirs. Our legs and thigh and everything is showing just like theirs. We're wearing the same tight clothes that they're wearing. And the youth say, "Wait a minute, that's hypocrisy." We begin to say, "You know what? You shouldn't gossip and talk about people and so on." But do you know how many mothers and fathers literally slander the ministers of God right before their children's faces? Go to the book of Matthew chapter 24. Go there with me. We're going to talk about the Bible. You see, this is the point that God is trying to bring across. He wants to not only give us a gospel that's lip service, he wants to give us a gospel that has a corresponding experience in our daily lives. This is when the gospel's powerful, saints. You see, in Matthew, the 24th chapter, notice what the Bible says. Do you know this happens right now? This happens right now. And we don't understand the seeds that we sow even before our own children, even before our own youth. In Matthew, the 24th chapter, look at what Jesus said here. This is amazing. Jesus said something. He says this. In Matthew 24, verse 44, the Bible says, watch this. The Bible says, "Therefore, be ye also ready, for in such an hour as you think not, the Son of Man cometh. Who then is a faithful and wise servant whom his Lord hath made ruler over his household to give them meat in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. Now watch this. Verily I say unto you that he shall make him ruler over all his goods. Now watch Jesus' transition. He's no longer talking about the good wise servant. Now he's talking about an evil servant. I want you to look at how Jesus describes an evil servant. The Bible goes on now to say, but and if that evil servant shall say in his heart, my Lord delayeth his coming. In other words, the Lord's not coming as soon as we think. They hear ministers go around talking about Jesus is about to come. Time is almost finished. And they say, oh, man, give me a break. That's a joke. We heard that thing when we were 4 years old. Now we're 40 years old. Please keep quiet. We begin to say, oh, the Lord delays his coming. And that's one of the signs of those that Jesus says was an evil servant. But then after that, look at what else is a description. He not only says that the Lord delays his coming, but verse 49 says, and shall begin to do what? Smite his fellow servants. Brothers and sisters, you know, one time I was thinking to myself, I said, you mean to tell me that the people in the church one day would begin to hit their brothers and sisters? That's what the word smite means. Smite means to hit, you know, to strike. I said, could it be that somebody could preach the gospel one day and get struck for it? And I said, that's a little far-fetched in my mind. And then you know what God did? God says, go to the book of Jeremiah 18 and let me show you how fellow servants get smited. So notice what the Bible says in Jeremiah, the 18th chapter. Let me show you how fellow servants can get smited. Because I was thinking, how could God, I mean, people would just start beating each other up in the church. I mean, that would be pretty bold to go up to somebody. I mean, I understand what it is to not like a minister's message, but man, to walk up to him and punch him in the face. I said, would that really happen? But here it is that the Bible says, no, it's not necessarily. I mean, that can happen. It happened to Jesus, so it can happen to us. But there's another way that we smite our fellow servants that I want you to consider, because this one may be more widely practiced and many of us are not aware of it. It's found in the book of Jeremiah, the 18th chapter. I want you to turn to Jeremiah 18 and I want you to see what the Bible says. In Jeremiah, the 18th chapter, I want you to see what it says right there in the 18th verse. Jeremiah chapter 18, and we're going to look at verse 18. Now, you know Jeremiah, he was the weeping prophet. He was one who was consistently experiencing the rejection from Israel because he would consistently tell Israel, you guys are getting yourselves in trouble because you're turning away from the Lord, and the people didn't want to hear that, so therefore they would do everything bad to him. Well, here it is now that in Jeremiah 18, in verse 18, notice what the Bible says next. It says, then said they, come and let us devise devices against Jeremiah. The people literally said, let's come together and let's put together things to fight against Jeremiah. Then it says, for the law shall not perish from the priest, nor counsel from the wise, nor the word from the prophet. And then it says, come and let us do what? Smite him. But watch this. It says, come and let us smite him with the tongue. Oh, wait a minute. That adds a whole new picture now. Jesus said, yes, there are some who come, and he says they will smite their fellow servants. And Jesus said, those were what kind of servants? Evil servants. And I'm thinking, you mean to tell me they're going to strike God's people? But according to the verse, are they striking them with their hand? No, they're striking them with their tongue. The Bible says, it says, come and let us smite him with the tongue, and let us not give heed to any of his words. Do you know how many times God's servants will preach the gospel? They'll preach the straight truths. They'll teach the messages that are designed to bring about an experience that we can run to Jesus for salvation and power to live a holy life. And do you know that there are fellow servants in the congregations that will hear the message? They know that it came from the word, but they don't like it because it disrupts their comfort zones. And as a result of that, you know what they do when the sermon is over? And can you imagine? They do it before their wives and their children. And they begin to say that lunatic didn't know what he was talking about. And they begin to use that tongue and smite their fellow servants and take heed to none of those words. Brothers and sisters, we must understand that when we claim to be Christians, it is not enough to just be part of a group. It's not enough to just be part of a church. It's not enough to even do activities in the church. And if you don't believe me, go to Matthew chapter 7. Now watch this, Matthew the 7th chapter. In Matthew the 7th chapter, notice what the Bible says now. Watch this, it's so clear. Jesus wants to get this point across to us because, brothers and sisters, I'm telling you, there's a great work for us to do and little time in which to do it. And brothers and sisters, we can't afford to waste any more time. We have to get the gospel to go from our head to our hearts. And the Bible says in Matthew, the 7th chapter, notice this, we think that if we just serve enough, that somehow this is going to merit us eternal salvation. But let me show you what the Bible says. Matthew, the 7th chapter. Look at what Jesus says. Very solemn, brothers and sisters. In Matthew, the 7th chapter, right there in verse 21, the Bible says, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. But he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not what? Prophesied in thy name. That means that even preachers, it is possible to preach, to prophesy, to proclaim God's message and yet be a servant of Satan. It goes on to say, not only did they prophesy in his name, it says, and in thy name have done what? Cast out devils. Now, brothers and sisters, if somebody came in this room right now and they came screaming and foaming at the mouth and came and kicking up chairs and everything, and if you saw me just say to them, peace be still, demon come out of that church, that person. Do you know that if that person all of a sudden was wild and then just became calm? Do you know many of you would probably look at me and say, there is a man of God. But do you know that the Bible says that there will be people who will do that? They will literally cast out demons from people. And then not only that, look at what else it says. It says, not only did they cast out devils, but it says, and in thy name done what? Many wonderful works. Brothers and sisters, doing many wonderful works. Feeding the homeless. Doing wonderful works. Singing for the glory of God. Doing wonderful works. Visiting people who are sick. Doing wonderful works. Preaching the gospel. Doing wonderful works. Giving money to the cause. Doing all sorts of great works. And Jesus, who's watching all these workers, he says unto them in the end, what? He says, depart from me, ye that work iniquity, I never knew you. It is not enough to participate in choirs. It is not enough to preach from the pulpit. It is not enough to be a member in the right organization, the right body. It's not enough. The question is, are you doing the will of God? And do you even know what the will of God is, saints? You know what the will of God is? That's how Jesus literally contrasted it. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Brothers and sisters, it's a wrap. It's done. It is over. If you're doing the will of your Father in heaven, you are heaven bound. So I believe it's imperative to understand what is the will of God. You want to know what the will of God is? 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Go there with me. The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, what is the will of God then? In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 now, we find out exactly what the will of God is. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, notice what the Bible says. We're going to let the scripture speak. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, notice what the Bible says as we consider verse 3. The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, it says, for this is the will of God, even your what? Sanctification. God's will for you and for me is that we are not just simply an intelligent people, but a sanctified people. To be sanctified is to be holy as God is holy. When that's accomplished, heaven bound. And not until then. And just because we preach does not mean we're sanctified. People come to me and I deal with this. I deal with this a lot because I travel all over this planet. And every time I go somewhere, you know what people say to me? You know what people actually say to me? Oh, saints of God, they don't even know what they're saying. My heart goes out to them. They don't understand. People come to me often. And you know what they say? They say, Brother Lemon, you are a man of God. And you know why they say that? I'm talking to you, saints. You know why people say that? because of the way I preach. Didn't you just read from the Bible that it's possible that somebody could preach very powerfully and still be a servant of the devil? Didn't we just read that? So why are you calling me a man of God just because I preach? Just because I say words that might have power to it, that touches your heart? How do you know I'm not a devil? In disguise. Do you know how many ministers have preached from pulpits? How many elders have preached from pulpits? And when they got off of the pulpits, they literally were committing fornication with the members of the church. Do you know how many times that has happened? I literally was doing an evangelistic meeting in one place, and I remember that as we were working with all these people, we had almost 50 people get baptized in an evangelistic meeting. Do you know that one of the women who got baptized, one day we had an elder assigned, and this elder, he was very powerful in his preaching, very powerful. And this elder, he was preaching and preaching, and people loved to listen to him preach because he had charismatic, he had that nice strong voice, and he was preaching the word. And do you know that that elder, one day we couldn't find him. We literally were calling all over. They said, where in the world is the elder? We called his house. He wasn't there. And nobody knew where he was. And they realized he ran away. And guess what we found out? He was sleeping with one of the new converts. He was literally having sex with one of the new converts. Powerful preacher. But he was an unsanctified man. Brothers and sisters, a man is not a sanctified individual just because they do a certain Christian work. And you and I are not sanctified and holy people simply because we sing on choirs, preach from pulpits, and go out to feed the homeless and provide shelter for those who don't have it. That does not mean by default that we are children of God. In the eyes of God, there's only one kind of people that's going to make it to the kingdom. It is those who are sanctified. God's presence in them, God's life lived out through them. And that was the whole purpose of the gospel. Young people, if you're going to go ahead and sing for Jesus, but when church is over, you're listening to the same worldly music that every other person who knows nothing of Jesus and denies his existence listens to, you are testifying you're not connected to God. You're testifying of that. And God says, that's not what I want for my people. I don't want you to come on a Sabbath and act. That's not what God wants for you. I know that's what happens when we watch too much TV. By beholding, we become changed. And we love watching acting so much, we start to act. We come to church and we say, holy is his name. And then we leave here and literally repeat the words of Beyonce and Jay-Z and every other worldly artist. How in the world does that happen? Honestly, think with me. Think with me. How could that happen? How could it that earlier today it was about Jesus and his truth? Later tonight, it's about the world and their wickedness. And you know what? Some of us are nodding our heads saying, that's right, talk to those young people. But no, I'm talking to you. First of all, parents, I want to ask you, how in the world did your young person end up with Jay-Z and Beyonce in their iPods? How did they end up with it in their iPads? How is it that they ended up with all these things? Maybe we as parents, we dropped our guard and did not give them proper instruction and thought that by giving them liberty and letting them do these things, that someday they'll just grow out of it. You know, right now, some of us, we let our children run around and do all sorts of things on the Sabbath day. Do you know the book Child Guidance, page 533, says that when parents allow their children to play on the Sabbath, God looks at the parents as Sabbath breakers. We have to understand, saints, that there needs to be a cooperation between us and Jesus. And sometimes it's not going to make people feel good. Sometimes it's not going to make people feel great. Sometimes people are going to say, you know what, you're weird, you're different. But brothers and sisters, Jesus was different. God says that I want you to be a peculiar people. It's all right to be different. Sometimes, let me tell you something. You know, one of the things that amazes me is when I come to other countries and I see a bunch of people trying to act like Americans. There's a side of that that really annoys me. I'm serious. That annoys me because I'm saying, what are you doing? Why are you trying to act like us? We are not worthy of imitation. There are many things that are done in America that is bona fide wicked. And we want to go ahead and imitate it here in these other countries where we think we're deprived. And I look at that, I watch young boys and they're trying to walk like they're thugged out and like they're coming out of some rap video. And I'm saying, what in the world are you doing? You didn't come out your mother's womb walking like that. You understand what I'm saying? We try to imitate. what we watch on TV and the world, and we think that that's cool. Brothers and sisters, the devil is pimping you. He's literally using you and playing with you and puppeteering you and trying to make you think it's all right when it's all wrong. I've been down that road. I'm telling you, saints, do you know what it's like to watch a man get a gunshot in his eye? I saw that. Do you know what it's like to hold a 9mm pistol and aim it at somebody and shoot it? I know that. Do you know what it's like to get caught up into fights and have guns shot at you on a regular basis? I know that. And yet we think that that stuff is cool. Brothers and sisters, it's not cool. It's not good. It's deadly. It is because of the mercy and grace of God that I'm able to stand here before you, and now I have become public enemy number one against the devil and his kingdom. Because I understand what that wickedness and that deception does to us. We think that watching those videos and dressing half naked and all these things, sisters, you are more precious than you will ever know. You should not go around wearing these high heel shoes and wearing these short mini skirts and these low cleavage. You are worth more than that. Go to the book of Proverbs chapter 7. Let me show you something. We're studying the word of God. Do you know that God is literally shifting my whole message? I am literally going as the Spirit downloads. Go to the book of Proverbs, the 7th chapter. Notice what God says here. Proverbs, the 7th chapter. I want you to see this, saints. God wants to do something inside of us that can change us so the power of the gospel can be realized. The Bible says in Proverbs, the 7th chapter, when you get there, let me know by saying amen. Now notice this. In Proverbs, the 7th chapter, here's what the Bible says. Proverbs chapter 7. And now we're going to go ahead and look at verse 10. Now look carefully at Proverbs 7 and verse 10. The Bible says, and behold, there met him a woman with the what? With the attire of an harlot. Now watch this. According to the verse, was the woman a harlot in the verse? No. According to the verse, what does the Bible say? She had on clothing that literally referenced harlotry. You understand that? So that means, brothers and sisters, that sometimes it's possible that you can be an innocent and pure person, but you could be wearing clothing that makes you give off a message to the beholders that you are open and lewd and ready to be used. This is why the Bible says that there was the attire of a harlot. Now, brothers and sisters, I wish that I could study with you dress reform. I really do. I wish I could do it. I wish we could just have time. Because I want you to see what the Bible and what the spirit of prophecy says about how God's daughters should dress. How God's men should dress. Because now the message needs to go to men. Because guess what you have in the Philippines? You have a lot of men that want to be like women. Oh, I wish I could laugh with you, but it is not a laughing matter. Brothers and sisters, homosexuality is a sin. It's a sin, saints of God. You must understand. Go to the book of Leviticus 18 with me. Go to there. Look at this. Look at what God says about homosexuality. It's serious. And right now we have so many young people that are looking at other men, looking at men and burning in their hearts with a desire for men. That was not the will of God. An enemy hath done this. Go to the book of Leviticus, the 18th chapter. Look at what the Bible says. There are many of us today, we are dressing more representing harlotry than we are representing holiness. The Bible says in Leviticus, the 18th chapter, watch this one. In Leviticus, the 18th chapter, right here, we're looking at Leviticus 18, and now we're going to go ahead and look at verse 22. Notice what the Bible says. In Leviticus chapter 18 and verse 22, it says, thou shalt not lie with mankind as with womankind, for it is an abomination. The word abomination means God hates it. When a man begins to sleep or participate in physical activities with another man as God designated to be done with another woman, the Bible says that's an abomination. That's offensive to God. God does not approve that. This is also brought out even more so in Romans chapter 1. Now watch this. Romans the first chapter. Take a look here now. In Romans chapter 1, notice this, because this is a serious issue. This is the issue in America, but it's an issue here in the Philippines as well. The Bible says in Romans, the first chapter now, look at what the Bible says. Romans chapter 1, talking about people who, unfortunately, they didn't want to honor God. They didn't want to do God's will. So as a result of that, they found themselves now going towards what the lusts in their hearts desired. And notice how the Bible spells it out in Romans chapter 1. The Bible says in Romans chapter 1, it says, for this cause, verse 26, Romans 1, 26, it says, for this cause, God gave them up unto vile affections, for even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error, which was meet. The Bible is very, very clear that God does not approve of homosexual lifestyle or behavior. God loves the homosexual, but God hates homosexuality. And it's not enough to just say, well, I'll just desire men in my heart, but I just won't touch them. Brothers and sisters, God wants to give you a pure heart so that you may have pure actions. How do you get it? David said, create in me a clean heart. Renew a right spirit within me. You can ask God for that. You don't have to be a slave to everything your body wants. You don't have to be a slave to everything your body lusts after and desires. Once you know that you desire things that are against the will of God, you don't want to lean on the excuse and say, well, I'm born that way, and start going into all this DNA stuff. What you want to do is say, well, this is the bend of sin that my life desires, but it's still sin. But Lord, you said you can create in me a clean heart. You promised a new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away your stony heart, and I will give you a heart of flesh. Do you believe God can do that? Brothers and sisters, God can do that. Sisters, go to the book of 1 Timothy chapter 2. I presented the problem, but let me give you the solution. We're getting ready to close in just a moment here, but I want to give you this. 1 Timothy chapter 2. In 1 Timothy chapter 2 now, notice what the Bible says here. This is just straight Bible study what we're doing. We're just going through the Word of God. We're letting the Word of God guide us and instruct us. The Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 2, right there in verse 9, you see, there are women who can dress with the garments of harlotry. Now, brothers and sisters, if you carefully study the Bible, when you study the Bible, you'll see that God did not want your thighs to be seen by the naked eye. God did not want your crotch area to be seen by the naked eye. God did not want your backside to be seen by the naked eye, or having clothing that hugs up against it. God didn't want that. God did not want you to wear low cleavage shirts where the breast area is going before the naked eye. These are things that are referred to as garments of harlotry. This is what the prostitute would wear. This is something that the prostitute would wear to let the beholders know, I'm available. I am willing to be used to give you pleasure. This was the way they could communicate. We see through the Bible that clothing has a personality. So therefore, this is not what God wants. So the question is, what does God want? 1 Timothy 2 and verse 9. The Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 9, it says, in like manner also, that women adorn themselves in what kind of apparel? The Bible says modest apparel. Modest apparel. And it goes on to say, with shamefacedness and sobriety, not with broidered hair or gold or pearls or costly array, but which becometh women professing godliness with good works. Sisters, let me tell you something. It's a blessing when you begin to cover your body in such a way that only the man who is privileged to be your husband knows about the particulars. That's a blessing. It's not a curse. That's what I'm saying. Y'all got to stop looking at America. Not everything that comes from America is good. All these sisters in America who are revealing their bodies and making themselves look like glorified whores. That's not God's will for your life. That is not what God wants for you. God says that I want you to represent yourself like the pure, holy child of God. And by the way, Christian dress does not mean ugliness. Christian dress does not mean to look ugly. Now, sisters, that was your opportunity to say amen. In other words, God is not saying that dress reform means you have to look like a scarecrow. God is not saying that dress reform means that you have to look bad. And you want to know why I know this? Because watch this. Oh, can I show you something sweet? Can I show you something sweet? Go to the book of 1 Peter chapter 2. Watch this now. Something sweet. Watch this. 1 Peter chapter 2. This is what I'm talking about, saints. This is what God wants to do. He wants us to understand in the day-to-day lives, in our eating, our drinking, and our dressing, in all of these different ways, we can glorify God. Notice what the Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 2. Watch this now. 1 Peter chapter 2. I want to show you something sweet. Because sometimes I've noticed that our sisters will fight against dress reform because in their mind they interpret it to mean, you mean I got to look like some old washed out woman now? You mean I got to look all outdated and played out and I got to look all ugly? That's not the answer. No, look at 1 Peter chapter 2. Notice what the Bible says. Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 2 in verse 9. Watch this now. It says, but ye are a what? Chosen generation. A royal priesthood. What else? A peculiar people, a holy nation. And what else? A peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Question. Is this verse talking about men only? Yes or no? Is this counsel for God's women as well? So God says to both men and women, he says, you're my chosen generation, you're my royal priesthood, you are my holy nation, and you are my peculiar people. Is that right? So that means that in a certain sense, not in all senses, in a certain sense, that means that we can apply to our sisters that they too are part of the royal priesthood. Yes? Did you know that God gave instructions to priests on how to dress? Go to the book of Exodus 28 and let me show all of the priests in this room how God said we should dress. Notice what the Bible says in Exodus, the 28th chapter. Watch this now. In Exodus, the 28th chapter, watch what the Bible says. Watch what the Bible says. In Exodus chapter 28 now, notice what God says as it relates to his priests. The Bible says in Exodus, the 28th chapter, notice how God gave instruction to the priests. And because we are all a royal priesthood, that means that this context of this principle can apply to us as well. The Bible says in Exodus 28, 1 and 2, notice what the Bible says. It says, and take thou unto thee Aaron thy brother, and his sons with him from among the children of Israel, that he may minister unto me in the priest's office, even Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, Eleazar, and Ithamar, Aaron's sons, and thou shalt make what kind of garments? So notice that the Bible says, thou shalt make holy garments for Aaron thy brother for two things. What were the purpose of the garments? What were the garments supposed to reflect? For glory and for beauty. So according to the Bible, does God teach that when the priests would put on their clothes, that it should represent glory? And we learned last night that glory is God's character, and that it should also represent what else? Beauty. So is God against beauty? No, he is not. Even if the beauty is manifested in how we dress. Sisters, God is not against you looking beautiful in your clothing. But don't believe the lie of the devil that the only way you can look beautiful is when you reveal yourself. That's a lie. That's a lie. That lie needs to be debunked. That lie needs to be exposed. You can be beautiful women of God and cover your body and let your particulars maintain a state of mystery to the beholders. The men on the street and the men in the church are not worthy to know what your precious bodies look like. To know what your precious bodies look like. Do you understand what the preacher's saying? And so it is that this is the ideology, saints. God says, I want my people to understand there's a great work to be finished. The gospel must go. The gospel must go. It is the solution to life's problems. But brothers and sisters, if you and I will not embrace the experience of the gospel, then how in the world can you share it with others? People will look at you and they'll laugh at you. They'll say, you're joking, man. You're not even following your own message. Remember what Paul says? You who say thou shalt not commit adultery, do you commit adultery? You who say you shall not say, do you steal? You see, the church of the living God today, we have gotten stuck in giving messages that we don't even know of its experience ourselves. And as a result of that, the gospel gets frustrated. But God says, I want to change that. God says, I want to change that. Listen, I understand. Some of you have been hurt. Some of you are preacher's kids. You know, some of the most dangerous people in the world are preacher's kids. Listen to what I'm saying to you. You know why? Because sometimes a preacher's child might have been so deeply exposed to hypocrisy that they become spiritually numb to the message of the gospel. Most ministers don't live their message. Most. And as a result of that, if a young person sees their daddy, who is preaching the word, and their daddy is hardly ever home, but the daddy says, we need to put our homes first. To the child says, I'm confused. How can you say the home comes first, but then you're never home? So the child gets confused. The child says, that's hypocrisy. Then if the daddy says, we must live right, we must not involve ourselves in the things of the world, and so on and so forth, and we preach that thing. And the next thing you know, the young people see daddy more involved in playing dominoes and board games and everything else than going out on the streets and telling the people dying in sin that there's a savior that is available to save them even now. The young people say, "What? My own daddy loves pleasure more than he loves God." But yet he's telling everybody they need to preach. And what happens is the preacher's children begin to get so heavily exposed. And that's why once God called me into ministry, well, even before then, but especially when God called me into ministry, I said, Lord, please help me to be such an example to my children that they will be able to one day say, I love what my daddy does to the point that if I grow up or as I grow up, I want to be just like my dad. I want to be able to do what my dad does. I want to be able to share it. That's why it becomes so imperative as ministers that we give very good pictures to our children of what it is to be a child of God. Especially, and I especially say this if there's anybody in this room that are quote unquote preacher's kids. I understand how sometimes you get numb. You get numb. The gospel doesn't do anything to you anymore. And now all of a sudden there's all this action of rebellion. We dress how we want. We act how we want. We say what we want because we're just mad. Brothers and sisters, please don't punish Jesus for the inconsistent examples that were exposed in your homes, perhaps. The inconsistent examples that, don't punish God. You know, I used to work at a mental institute. I used to work in a mental institute, and I used to watch people who were called mentally retarded and dually diagnosed, mental illness, mental retardation. And you know one of the things I remember? I remember sometimes they would come to me and they say, they would say, Dwayne. And I say, yes. And they say, Dwayne, can I go outside? You know, they'll say something like that. They'll say, Dwayne, can I go outside? And I would say, no, you cannot go outside right now because we're not finished doing our first project. And you know what they would say to me? They would say, I want to go outside now. I say, no, you can't go outside right now. And you know what they would say? They would say, then you know what? I'm not going outside at all. And I remember one time I had to look at him and I had to say, do you understand that that's going to hurt you? It's not going to hurt me. That's going to hurt you. In other words, because they didn't get what they want, they started punishing themselves. Now, we look at that scenario and say, that's so foolish. But do you know we do the same thing? Brothers and sisters, did you know that God is the reason why you woke up this morning? Do you know God is the reason why you're able to take your hand and do that and exercise what's called motor skills? Do you know God is the reason why you're able to eat food every day? God is the reason why you live, move, and have your being. Now watch this. Do you know that sometimes when we see people, whether they're called father, mother, brother, sister, pastor, elder, or whatever, when we see people do wrong, do you know what we do? We say, well, it seems like dad wasn't living right. It seems like mom wasn't living right. It seems like brother, sister, pastor, elder, it seems like they're not living right. And you know what we do? We say, you know what? I'm not going to live right. And you know what happens? We're just like that person at that job, at that mental institute. Because you didn't get what you want through a good, consistent example, through mother, father, or brother, or sister, now you're going to go ahead and you're going to leave Jesus, who never did anything wrong to you, who gave you blessing after blessing after blessing, and now you're going to leave Jesus and say, well, I'm just going to go ahead and live a rebellious life since everybody else is. Brothers and sisters, that's foolish. Mom and dad may not have been a consistent example. Pastor and elders may not be consistent examples. brothers and sisters may not be consistent examples, but Jesus Christ has been a perfect example. And he's been a perfect provider. And it's not fair to him when we punish him for other people's faults. It's not fair. You shouldn't punish yourself because of the inconsistent examples of others. Brothers and sisters, Christ is trying to say the gospel that I created, the gospel that was birthed from the heart of Jesus, that gospel was designed to provide solutions to your problems. And Jesus says, please don't rebel against my gospel. I understand there's hardly anybody that you can see that's living it. Jesus says, I understand that, but that doesn't mean that it doesn't have power. Jesus says, I want you to talk to me. Stop looking to the left and to the right. Jesus says, focus on me. Look at me. Tell me what I did wrong to you. And when you look at Christ and you say, Lord, you didn't do anything to me, then what do you think we should do? We should render him the best of our service. We should render unto him the best of ourselves. We should go to God and say, Lord, I realize that I'm a sinner and I need help. I need this theory to become a reality in my heart. And God can do it, saints. These are the kind of discussions that I had to have with God. I remember being mad at God. I remember watching hypocrisy all around. You don't understand what I saw. When I got baptized into this church, brothers and sisters, I saw the greatest hypocrisies from ministers down. I started going into those ministers' homes, and what I saw there, I said, wait a minute. This is completely different from what you were preaching. And I got so turned off. I said, this gospel thing is a joke. But brothers and sisters, I'm so thankful that Jesus says, don't leave just yet. Christ put his hand on my shoulder and he says, you know what? Take your eyes off of these men. And Jesus says, I want you to start looking at me. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. The arms of flesh will fail you in this world, but Christ will never fail you. And you must allow him to let that gospel go from your head to your heart. Because it's when the gospel is experienced, now we have power to win others to the message as well. And so I'm going to present to you a very serious and very solemn appeal. I want to be honest with you. There are some people in this room right now that we are slaves to entertainment. We love the things of the world. We love the television. We love the movies. When it comes to Bible study, it's boring. We hate it. We're hardly there. But when it comes to TV, when it comes to movies, when it comes to the entertainment of the world, we are the first ones there and the last ones to leave. If you know that that is your life, and I'm talking both to youth and adults, if you know that that's your life, I'm letting you know right now, you have yet to experience the power of the gospel, and as a result of that, you're going to be lost if you stay in that condition. And God doesn't want you to be lost. He wants you to be saved. And so under the sound of my voice, if there's anyone in this room from the top or to the bottom, and if you can honestly say, I know for a fact that I love pleasure more than I love God. I love the TV. I love the movies. I love the video games. I love all that stuff, and I don't have a love for God. Brothers and sisters, do you know I had that same feeling? And I went to God and I said, Lord, I don't love you. Oh, saints of God, I'm being honest with you. I went to God and said, I don't love you. But I'm thankful that I didn't just go to God and say, I don't love you. I said, I don't love you, but I want to love you. I don't know how to do it, but I want to love you. I want to love this message, and I want this message to have a real effect and change on my life. And I said, Lord, please, make this gospel real to me. And do you know what God did? He answered that prayer in a most marked manner. And that's why today, saints, I stand before you not as an actor. God got me now. I'm serious. God got me now. I know what hypocrisy is. I know what it is to live a double life. I know what it is to go before people and preach nice messages, but when I get off the pulpit, to live that double life. I know it. But God says, I want to change that. And so if you're a slave to fashion, if you're a slave to pleasure, if you're a slave to all these things of the world, and you're saying, Lord, I need victory. I want you to put a love in my heart because I don't have it for you. But please, make this gospel real for me. Make it real in my heart so that I could really experience the power of the gospel in my life. If that is your testimony, I'm inviting you to stand to your feet. You're standing to your feet because you're being honest. You're saying, Lord, I don't love you. I really don't. But I want to love you. I want to get to know you better. And I want you to change me in my heart. That's why you're standing. That's why you're standing. You're saying, Lord, I want you to change me. I want to change. I want a real change in my heart. Now, there are times when we stand for certain appeals. It's a very general stand. But if there's even one who says, Brother Lemon, you touched on a special thing today. You know, I believe that the sin of homosexual lifestyle is pervading God's people. It's touching God's people, those in the church, not just in the world, but in the church. There are men right now that in their hearts, they desire other men as a man would desire a woman. There are women right now who desire women as a woman would desire a man. And brothers and sisters, it's not enough that you don't touch anybody, because as a man thinks in his heart, so he sooner or later will be in his actions. It will come out sooner or later. And therefore, if there's anybody in this room and you have that battle and you have that struggle going on in your heart where you're saying, you know what? In my heart, I am desiring things that I know God condemns. And I want Jesus to change that in my heart. This is what I want you to do. Because this is so sensitive, I am not asking you to make a public stand here before everybody. Because not everybody can handle these type of acknowledgments. But I'm letting you know that I am willing, open, and available without judgment to counsel with you, to pray with you, that God will give you victory. And if you're going through that specific struggle of homosexual desire in your heart, and you're saying, Lord, I want victory over this, I am going to welcome you to come to me personally if you would like for me to pray with you. I believe God wants to give us victory over all sin, not just sin of action, but sin of desire. And God can do it. And so as you stand, I want you to know Christ stands with you. He wants you to experience the power of the gospel, and it begins today. And may the power of Jesus Christ rest, rule, and abide within you. And may you have victory. Indeed. Let us go before the Lord in prayer at this time, and as much of you as are able to, let's seal our decisions as we kneel before our Creator at this time. Father in heaven, we thank you for the way of the leading of your Spirit. Father, you know that there was a whole different message. You changed it in a moment. And Lord, I'm so grateful because I know that whenever you do this, it's because there was somebody in this room who needed it. And so as so many people have stood, Father, I praise you and I thank you for letting your will be accomplished. I thank you for the victories that you will give your people. I pray on behalf of every single one of my brothers and my sisters, Lord, make the gospel real to their hearts. Show them how you can take away the stony heart. You can give them a heart of flesh. Purify them, Lord. Bless them. And may they be counted amongst the faithful when Jesus shall come. It's our prayer we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.